Hi, hello, how are you doing? I very much enjoy gacha games, and if you've clicked on the video, I'd wager you do too. On the off chance you don't, me too. For those of you not in the know, a gacha game is a game where you unlock characters through gambling using in-game currency. Its namesake, Gachapon, is those toy capsule machines. There isn't really a defining feature outside of this, and gameplay varies greatly from game to game. You have tower defense, you have tower attack, you have Breath of the Wild. So, as a turbo version, I am the most qualified to objectively rank each game. So I looked up existing gacha tier lists on TierMaker and, wow. A grand wizard must have made this. However, if you take a moment to glance over this tier list, you'll find an abundance of anime-inspired gacha games. I don't care about these, and generally, neither do the developers, so we won't be ranking those. As a side note, apparently TierMaker needs access to my Twitter.
Why?
So we're going full scuff today. Editing colors in dark mode, Chrome glazed my mind over, so be grateful, Anya. Here we are. I've compiled the 19 gacha games that I've played in chronological order. I'll be grading these based on three criteria: core gameplay, longevity, and pay picking.
Hey everybody, it's me, Remison Post.
I'll be using each game's OST as a backing track when discussing them. This isn't a factor in consideration, but the music in each is surprisingly good. But that's enough exposition. Starting with Kantai Collection, Kancolle. This is what I'd consider to be one of, if not the, godfather of gacha games, featuring anthropomorphic ship girls. My Admiral Quarters is a bar. Kino. The gameplay centered around resource management, and you would use fuel, ammo, and the like for ship construction as well as sorting fleets. Most entertainment was derived from events where you would need to clear incredibly difficult maps in order to get a chance to drop event ships. I just realized I actually have Gangut, which absolutely made my day. Compound this with the fact that Kancolle is probably the only gacha game in existence to implement permadeath, and you've got a recipe for great gameplay. One of the ways Kancolle keeps players in the gameplay loop is EXP. Since fleet locking exists in events, you need an actual armada of strong leveled ships to complete events on the higher difficulties. Grinding EXP is mindless, but also simple. Even after they reworked 3-2 to counter some marine farming, I still ran it because old dog and all that. Furthermore, the game is free to play and not at all pay to win. The only shame is that if you play a couple events, then you won't have enough free Kanmasu slots available to hold your event ships and the regular construction ships. With such a glowing repertoire, you'd assume this is an easy ultra rare, right? Well, I've been using the past tense for a reason. See, Kancolle is a gacha game that actively does not want to be played, at least outside of Japan. Originally, you needed to win a goddamn lottery to create an account, which was a massive pain. Then, you needed to install an extension to circumvent playing overseas. And then there was an executable you needed to download. You get the gist. Becoming able to just log on and get footage of this game took me 3 grueling hours of hammering away at it, and the damn thing just decided to work for no discernible reason. The true programmer experience, I guess. Anyway, SSR as a result of the pain needed to make it work. Next is Clash Royale. Normally I wouldn't even consider this to be a gacha game, but I saw it on a different tier list, so why not, I guess. The gameplay is PvP tower defense, with cards being unlocked and upgraded via chests. There's many interesting card interactions in the game, but mostly victory hinges upon player skill and the ability to bait out essential crowd control cards. For context, I've had the same exact deck comp since day one with very little tweaks, so you can play any gimmick you want and you'll be barred only from the highest echelons of ladder. That being said, the game doesn't have very much to do once you've hit Legendary Arena. And although you can play whatever deck comp you want, the meta rears its rather ugly head at those highest rungs of ladder where gameplay is optimized. People frequently complain about cards like, say, Mega Knight or Electro Giant, or perhaps even Royal Giant, but as the resident P.E.K.K.A. enjoyer since day one, that is a pure skill issue. Since Clash Royale is based off of Clash of Clans, the clan system has been ported over. As someone who's led a clan for 4 years now, the clan system is a complete non-consideration. In an open clan, people are mostly there for card donations, which is just a way to accelerate the standard gameplay. In a clan with friends, the game itself isn't adding any value beyond those card donations anyway. Luckily, Clash Royale is completely accessible to children, which means that you don't necessarily need to pull out the credit card to be a winner. Of course, some time ago they added upgrade books, which completely circumvent the entire card collection aspect of the game, so they are trying to milk their player base, but if you've spent money on Clash Royale, that's just miserable. Uncommon tier. Fire Emblem Heroes, one of the best mobile games on the market, period, even outside of the category of gacha games. It features, as you should have surmised, characters from the various Fire Emblem games, as well as some original characters. The gameplay is what you'd expect from a mobile iteration of Fire Emblem. It inherited a simplified version of the Fire Emblem stats, and skills have been ported over as well. Outside of the whole character collection aspect, which is not being taken into account due to its wholly subjective nature, the greatest appeal of Fire Emblem Heroes is the character building, same as in standard Fire Emblem games. This is best shown through the My Summoner, who has access to all of your unit skills, so you can create some vile homunculus that has almost exclusively percent damage reduction skills, who'll just get murked by any meta unit. Like in most games, the meta only matters for the most competitive, but there's a catch. Literally anybody can get meta units. This is because Fire Emblem Heroes accelerates its power creep unlike any other game. So much so that if you were to make a brand new account and just pull the most recent banner, you could probably clean sweep every Abyssal map and up to tier 18 of Arena. That doesn't mean there isn't incentive for continued play, of course. Permanent buffs such as Dragon Flowers, Trade Fruits, and Ascendant Florets can only be attained in small recurring bursts. Fire Emblem Heroes release new game modes every now and then that are usually fresh and fun, but sometimes you also get Frontline Phalanx. If all else fails, I will log on to Fire Emblem Heroes at least once a year to vote F. Robin for Choose Your Legends, which is a popularity contest, where the two winners on the male and female side of the vote will get an alt. It's a cool little way of allowing players to influence what characters are made available for gacha, especially in a game series as expansive as Fire Emblem. Of course, this mostly just boils down to the most recent characters taking the cake, or, equally as depressing, lifeless titty monsters. As it goes, Fire Emblem Heroes requires no amount of money to be put into it in any capacity. The gacha rates in Fire Emblem Heroes are the best of any gacha game to the extent that I have never not pulled what I wanted given standard currency stockpiling tendencies. Maybe if you wanted to get a plus 10 and had less than 800 orbs, you would pull out the credit card, but even then, orbs are not hard to come by in any capacity, really. This is the easiest ultra rare of my life, and it only gets better if you like the Fire Emblem franchise. Now we have Girls Frontline and Azur Lane, the two games which I consider to be the spiritual successors to Kancolle. Let's start with Girls Frontline, which features anthropomorphic gun girls, a game after my warmongering heart. Looking at the material system and the crafting gacha, you can clearly see the influence of Kancolle. The swording is also similar, though you are always able to choose movement in Girls Frontline as opposed to in Kancolle, where routing was often based on your fleet composition. Plus there's the added aspect of multiple deployable squads, and you have to manage turns and resources, unlike in Kancolle. There's slightly more player interaction in Girls Frontline battles, as you can manually activate skills, as well as rearrange your units to avoid the highest damaging attacks. Then again, you'll practically never do this, but anyway. Again, like in Kancolle, there is a pool of regularly available T-dolls from the crafting system, and event T-dolls that have a chance to drop when clearing event missions. Regarding the meta, I have no idea how it works. I stopped playing a little over a year ago, and my 40k power team went from one of the top dogs to mediocre at best. Granted, Girls Frontline is pretty much exclusively PvE, so the meta isn't particularly important in the first place. Unfortunately, Girls Frontline's replayability isn't that great. Leveling is very easy and you'll mostly just be doing dailies while waiting for events. To Girls Frontline's credit, the events are great. I don't think any other gacha game has collabed with Valhalla, and having Donna Zane dropkick robots is dimes. It's just a shame that events don't have super great downtime. Also, trying to capture Sangus Fairy Ringleaders is practically impossible, at least without tickets. Girls Frontline is probably the game that least fosters whales. There's legitimately nothing in the game that cannot be attained through consistent play. Resources are abundant, and you can get a fair amount of premium currency just by triple meddling story missions. Although this isn't a criterion in consideration, I think that Girls Frontline has one of the best gacha stories, full stop. Granted, I usually skip through story text in gacha games. The game also crashes a lot for me, but that isn't really an inherent issue like with Kancolle. It's just specific to my phone OS, which is tilting beyond words. All things considered, SSR is a good fit. Azur Lane is the other successor to Kancolle, although it is more so spiritual than mechanically, as was the case with Girls Frontline. This is because it also features anthropomorphic ship girls, though the gameplay has been altered a fair bit. Resource management has been simplified into three commodities: fuel, money, and cubes, the last of which is essentially exclusively used for shipbuilding. Sorting uses fuel, but you get money, ships, and gear in the process. More often than not, fuel tends to be the bottleneck in resources. Unlike Kancolle and Girls Frontline, Azur Lane's event ships are crafted rather than dropped. Gear is the event map drop, and for good reason. Overall, gear is more important in the meta than ships. However, when speaking of meta, one assumes a baseline of having gear available, so there is a clear distinction in which ships are meta-worthy. I'm looking at New Jersey. Dailies are very simple, and you can auto-battle maps once full cleared, so Azur Lane is a game that can be thrown on in the background while doing other things. Much like Girls Frontline, Azur Lane really gets going during events, whereas otherwise it's quite streamlined. There's one aspect of Azur Lane that makes its longevity rarer than Girls Frontline, and that's the priority ships. Quite seriously, these are good ships, sometimes even meta ships, that are hard locked behind grinding with certain factions. You will have to play for a long while before you are able to unlock each one, and even then, more get released annually. The premium currency in Azur Lane is pretty hard to come by. Having enough dock spaces in free-to-play constantly feels like an uphill battle, but it's far from impossible. The only other reasons that you would want to put money into the game would be to oath various ships or to buy skins, which is possible to do if you refuse to upgrade the dock for whatever reason. SR for its benefits, though there isn't a standout feature to point to in this case, just an all-rounder of a game, unless you're a Coomer, in which case this game goes above and beyond ultra rare. Since I first wrote this script, Azur Lane has been getting criticized for being Coomer bait, which it is. The dev team really goes above and beyond with the live 2D skins, as in, they probably have more distinct settings than many VTubers. That said, I don't think this is a boon or a bane for Azur Lane, considering that I saved up gems to get Monarch's Sunrest skin, and I never use it, because, you know, uniforms are just peak. Fate Grand Order is consistently one of, and frequently the, most popular gacha game on the market. And for good reason. Taking place in the Nasuverse of anime-fied historical figures, Fate Grand Order offers some of the best gameplay in the genre. Rather than using resources, Fate Grand Order prefers a simple standard of stamina and gacha currency. The characters, christened servants, come with unique skills, attributes, skill cards, and ultimates. Those are noble fantasies. This leads to a plethora of possible strategies that don't frequently feel as though defeat was down to dumb luck. As is the norm so far, the meta isn't horribly necessary in the game. Certainly, Scotty looping and the like is almost essential to first clearing high difficulty event stages, but those are optional. Not only that, but if you're so inclined, you can continue a level after failure using command spells, which recharges a rate of 1 per day. With the continuous available, you can make any lineup work, even buster-focused comps which are considered the worst of the three types. 8 Grand Order events are also the cream of the crop, with most large events offering a free 4-star to keep with fully upgraded Noble Phantasms. They also offer earnable 5-star craft essences, which have various effects from starting the match with a readily available Noble Phantasm, to providing a percentage boost to a card's damage, or providing some amount of turns of invulnerability. Granted, the craft essences that provide in-battle buffs are generally the worst, but the biggest part of Fate Grand Order's longevity is intrinsically tied to Saint Quartz, or the Gacha currency. Fact of the matter is, it frequently feels as though the only way to get a large amount of Saint Quartz is to get login bonuses. Although the daily bonuses are pretty marginal, the bulk of login Saint Quartz comes from maintenance rewards or some other interaction campaigns that are always successful. Why is Saint Quartz so important, more so than in other Gacha games? Simply put, Fate Grand Order has some of the worst gacha game rates known to mankind. As in, I have never witnessed a game so intent on denying a dopamine hit. And it's pretty rough collecting Saint Quartz. If you've completed the available story missions and free missions, all that's really left available to you is forcing rank up quests and interludes by leveling random characters that might not be essential to any comp. All that being said, Fate Grand Order has what I consider to be the best gameplay of any gacha game, full stop. And although my personal experience with the gacha has been pretty horrendous when I actually want a specific character, as in, how do you burn well over 1500 Saint Quartz and not pull a Jalter? I must acknowledge that this isn't a standard experience, especially now that they've implemented a pity system. Fate Grand Order is proudly the second ultra rare. Arknights has risen in popularity since its release, taking its place at the forefront of gacha games. Its premise is one of tower defense, iterating on the genre with a time-based resource that can be accelerated through specific units. The materials in this game exist for the sole purpose of upgrades, be it for your units or, more frequently, the base. That being said, I'm going to showcase bias greater than I did when I placed Fire Emblem Heroes in Ultra Rare for F. Robin, because I'm still hard stuck on 210. I don't know if this is a progression wall or a skill issue or what have you. I just know that being unable to progress past the third act of the story had me fairly peeved. It very much so felt like a numbers issue, which was rather frustrating, but that was ultimately conjecture after I'd reworked my team based on guides to no avail. The way that gameplay was implemented feels fresh and fun in the gacha game scene, but if the difficulty really is just number bloat, well, I'm just not a fan of that. Anyway, I can't really assess the longevity of Arknights for the aforementioned reason of getting walled. The events are fairly generous in terms of providing the gacha currency, and you'll get a free 10 pull on event banners every now and then. Pretty much every forum I've seen on Arknights agrees that lower rarity operators can be serviceable, which eliminates the need to pull out the credit card. It does appear, however, that flash farming premium currency is difficult, which could influence such decisions if pulls are bad and one is particularly invested in a specific character. That's to say, Arknights is an SR. I originally avoided Mobile Legends Adventure because I thought it was related to League of Legends, which would demote me from a turbo version to subhuman filth. After a quick Google search, it turns out that Mobile Legends Adventure was made by the same developer as the real Mobile Legends. Its gameplay is pretty non-existent, and by design. It's marketed as an idle game, which, you know, as far as I'm concerned, is essentially not a game in the first place. It achieves what it sets out to do very well, but I wouldn't consider the idle gameplay to be anywhere near the peak of game design. The longevity of Mobile Legends Adventure is, funnily enough, pretty bad. This might just be me, but the more that a gacha game implements automated gameplay, the more likely I am to stop playing and not pick it back up. Is there a meta in Mobile Legends Adventure? Obviously, there's a meta in every game, but PvP isn't particularly important, so you can do whatever you want to clear the story and other single player content. The events are character banners, which are well thought out, but they also don't implement content, so the underlying issue is present. I still like the art style though, so... R. Konosuba Fantastic Days. It's an anime-inspired gacha game, and although said anime is one of my favorites, it's still bad. The gameplay is stale, and frankly, I stopped playing about after 3 hours total. You might say, that's not enough time to formulate an informed opinion. You would be correct, but I generally don't think I need to drink piss to know I won't like it, or that it's not fine dining. That is to say, its failure to keep my attention for longer than 3 cumulative hours is indicative of its quality. Plus, anime-inspired gacha games are essentially the soul of pay-picking, so I'm already heavily biased. I hate to say it, but this is our first common. Lord of Heroes. At an indeterminate point in time, I uninstalled it, so I'm going off the cuff here. The gameplay wasn't particularly unique. Dailies were simple, but powering through the story was a numbers slog, I think. The presentation of the story mode was good though, being that you had to sequentially conquer neighboring kingdoms. How were the gacha rates? Don't remember, which means that they weren't horrendous and neither were they generous. I can't realistically rank this one, so I'm dumping it in C. Illusion Connect is a fun gacha game. An addendum. It's been 9 months since I drafted this script, and Illusion Connect has since closed down, so I can't really rate it anymore. It was fun at the time, but you know, it's dead now, so what can you do? Based on what little I remember from it, in hindsight, I'll place it over in SR. Touhou Lost Word. I like Touhou. I have no idea how to play this game. The systems are foreign to me, and although I can extrapolate pretty easily, I just send the biggest numbers into battle. Is the core gameplay good? Not particularly. I feel like if I better understood the mechanics at play, then I might enjoy team building a bit more. But the thing is, I'm making a team of my favorites, and there's no stopping me, meta be damned. I wouldn't say that the longevity of Touhou Lost Word is great. The gameplay requires very little user interaction, which means that there's no skill to cultivate or entertainment to be derived. The biggest plus in Touhou Lost Word's favor is that a casual player will not have to whip out the credit card. There's a daily pull system called the Corando Roulette, where you can get 5-star characters and story cards, which are like craft essences. That being said, the event banners are pretty rough, but you should be able to accumulate enough premium currency to pretty consistently draw what you want. Beyond that, I would personally never wail on Touhou Lost Word. Between wailing and a FUMO, I'd rather get to FUMO, and I have practically no interest in getting a FUMO in the first place, so that's your frame of reference. This is overall a nice little SR.
And the game award goes to Genshin Impact.
Genshin Impact is probably the most notorious gacha game that even non-gacha players have heard of. At its launch, people called it anime Breath of the Wild, but now people acknowledge it for what it always was, brain rot. It also happens to be the only gacha game that I've played on desktop, which means that I actually didn't skip through the story, so I can finally comment on that. Anyway, I played from about release until Azdaha came out, took a break until Raiden Shogun dropped, played a little bit more, and I haven't played since. This means I'm going to have to re-download the game, which I never thought I'd do, but we all have to bite the bullet sometimes. Yes, I like Hu Tao. She's a nuclear warhead and a poet. Anyway, the core gameplay is relatively fun. When you start out, the map is grayed out, and as you explore, you run across side quests, puzzles, and mysterious landmarks, which are all fun. Except for the fetch quests, but what can you do? The world feels populated, and wherever you go there will be something for you to do. Populating the world are various types of enemies. On one hand you have the Hitchcurls, which are Genshin's equivalent of goblins. They're primitive and the simplest enemy type. Their attacks are simple, and they generally have no defenses other than shields, which can be easily broken or circumvented entirely. Each region has hitchcurls and a regional equivalent, like the fodder samurai in Inazuma. Elite enemies are trickier to deal with. For the Abyss faction, which the hitchcurls are a part of, the elite enemies are usually Abyss mages. These plushy bastards have bubbles, which reduce damage by a huge percent, tend to have annoying crowd control abilities, and teleport frequently. Sometimes they come in packs, or at the very least with a band of hitchcurls to tie you up. What's the solution to these fuzzy rats? Elemental damage. Their shields get melted by elemental damage, and so do most elite enemies, including the Fatui. So, as you can figure, elements are very important to Genshin's gameplay, so how do you utilize them? You get 4 character slots in the party, with each character having an elemental alignment. I'll say this right now, the characters are by far the biggest draws in Genshin. You can play as a Soulsborne protagonist, you can play as a Battery, you can play as Ted Kaczynski Reincarnated, and you can mix and match any combination of 4 of these characters. So you can play as the Poet Buddies who actually have good synergy, or you can play with Fischl and literally anyone else because she drops an electric auto turret. Or you can play with Barbara and literally anyone else and kill yourself because she places a persistent water status on you. Why is this bad? Well, when 2 elements are simultaneously applied to an enemy, they have unique interactions. For example, fire and electricity will cause overloaded, which will do AoE damage upon reaction. Water and fire will cause vaporize, which makes the triggering attack deal 1.5 times more damage. This makes forming parties more fun because you can prioritize certain elemental reactions over others. But now we can also return to Barbara. Because elemental reactions can trigger on your characters as well. So you're fighting an Ice Abyss Mage that only deals ice damage, which doesn't really do anything on its own, but now you're playing Barbara. And you try to pop her E-skill, which is how you apply water to enemies and heal yourself. If you get sneezed on by the Abyss Mage, you're getting frozen, which is arguably the worst elemental reaction to have applied on you. Now we can start talking about bosses. We can mostly divide them into 2 categories, field bosses and weekly bosses. Field bosses are fairly simple, which is best exemplified by the flower field bosses. They have an elemental shield which, when broken, stuns them for a while and allows you to do heavy damage. Outside of this, they have limited movesets which are basically just going to be AoEs, and they don't really move at all. The cubes are similar. They have simple movesets and they are only vulnerable for a small while following attacks. Once they are damaged enough, they enter stun, allowing them to be damaged heavily, and then their stun gauge resets. On the other hand, weekly bosses are the most fun you can have in this game. They usually unlock after you fight them through story progression, which allows for a significant build-up of their character. Genshin dropped the ball with their first weekly boss in the Dragon, but Tartaglia, Signora, and Raiden Shogun are all phenomenal bosses. Flowey over there might headbang, but look at this dude with a double power-up shooting a whole whale at me. The movesets are engaging, their mobility keeps you light on your feet, and their face changes brings the right brand of intensity. There is one bad weekly boss, though, as Daha the Earth Dragon. So you know how field bosses are just AoE spam with elemental resistance? Azdaha is out on steroids. I don't know what the counterplay to this fat bastard is, and I don't care. I refuse to fight him again. I touched upon exploring the world, but how's the environment? It's pretty good. The regions are quite varied in that you have Germany, China, Japan, and I know literally nothing about the newest region. The sub-regions are the most interesting though. You can enter a small, iridescent cave, you can come across Yggdrasil, you can enter Blackreach. The world does feel vast and it's only getting bigger. Admittedly, the NPC interactions are usually uninteresting, but sometimes you get the blind girl waiting for her husband, or this Fatu who isn't a complete swine. I haven't even talked about the teapot, fishing, boating, or any of the other systems that have been implemented into Genshin over time. But there is just an insane amount of things that you can do in the world of Teyvat. That was the longest explanation of core gameplay by far, but Genshin also has the most content by far, so there's no avoiding such a discrepancy. From the core gameplay, you might think that Genshin is an ultra rare. Well, let's talk about the longevity of this game. The question, then, what do you do in Genshin after you've finished exploring? What do you do once you've caught up with the story and there's no event going on? The answer? Nothing. Well, not necessarily nothing. I've purposely neglected to talk about one specific mechanic of Genshin, resin. Resin is a resource that limits doing dungeons and weekly bosses. Well, it doesn't prevent you from playing through them, but it means that you won't get rewards for doing so. The rewards being artifacts and equipment to make your character stronger. Essentially, resin is stamina in other gacha games, which is somewhat annoying if you want to get perfect artifacts. The thing is though, you don't need perfect artifacts to bulldoze through the story. Once you hit level 80, maybe even 90 with decent artifacts, you pretty much don't need to use resin, unless you're trying to do more than 9 floors in the abyss, which is completely optional. That is all to say that Genshin can keep you hooked for a long time, but once the story runs out, which will admittedly take far longer now than it did for me, there's nothing to keep you glued. Hell, the core gameplay will start to become stale too, since you'll find your optimal or favorite team comp and stick with it. Last, we can talk about the gacha system. If you're pulling on every new character banner, you're not gonna have enough Primo Gems, which is a premium currency. Other than that, you're gonna be fine if you do dailies and complete all the content. The rates themselves aren't horrendous, and there is a soft pity system. You'll almost never have to pull more than 80 times to get a 5-star. The one thing is that both weapons and characters are factored into pity, so there is a 50-50 chance that popping pity will result in you getting a weapon instead of the character you want. If you pop pity again, then you'll guaranteed get a character, but I don't remember if it's guaranteed to be the featured banner character or not. Do you need to pay pig? No, almost not at all. You should never spend money on resin, and you'd have to get horrendously unlucky or want every character to spend money on Primo Gems. The last time I poked my head into Genshin, they started implementing skins into the game, which is good. I like Jean's swimsuit skin, but I don't have Jean, so it's a non-consideration. And I wouldn't buy it in the first place because her original skin is just better. Overall, an SR. My heart wants to give it the only fodder rating in the entire tier list, but I will admit that the gameplay was unique and interesting for a long while. Really, my bias is what's taking it down from UR to SR considering everything it has to offer, but I also don't think that it has any draw once you've burnt out. All things considered, add Arlecchino now! Make her a playable character now! I'll bump the rating up to SSR when that happens. Nier Reincarnation is a gacha game based off of a real game series. In fact, the contender for my favorite game series, to be specific. Sadly, I wouldn't say that the core gameplay reflects Nier very well. It really is a standard gacha game system, with a stamina resource, premium currency, character equipment, upgrade resources, and hands-off combat. Keeping that in mind, the longevity of the game is capped in the legs. Considering that you have an uninteresting combat system, coupled with a self-imposed gameplay timer in the form of a stamina system. Exploring the world is the most unique part of this game, although on my old phone it was a little laggy. Nier games are loved by their most invested fans for the story. However, it's a gacha game. I won't read the story. And every developer knows this. That's why they all implement the skip button on the top right. Hell, I still need to get around to reading short story long, so this really isn't high on my list of priorities. Do you need to whip out the MasterCard? Not from what I've gathered. When I started playing with the Automata batter, I was able to pull A2 and 9S. I would have gladly traded 9S for 2B, but I got what I came for. It's not super hard to stockpile gems by churning through the story, but I can't speak to how easy it is to get gems after you're all caught up. It deserves an R, I'll give it an SR just because it's Nier. Alchemy Stars brings that bejeweled energy to the function that gacha heads love. Actually, never mind, not bejeweled, but I can't remember the game that it's emulating. Basically, your characters are on tiles, and you connect the highest number of same colored tiles as possible in order to attack enemies adjacent to the drawn path, doing a special attack at the end of the path contingent upon its length and color. This allows for a degree of randomness, in the sense that there's the tile generation, but it also is unique enough in the gacha game sphere that the gameplay is fairly engaging. When I played, there was a Persona 5 Royale banner going on, which was okay, and I pulled Joker, but overall I'm not really sure what it added to the game in terms of, you know, actual gameplay. How is the longevity? Well, since I stopped playing and never looked back, I wouldn't say it's great. There's only so much variation you can place onto the core gameplay, which is to say that it can get stale very quickly. Upgrade resources are an unentertaining bottleneck, especially coupled with the stamina system. How necessary is pay picking? Well, you'll have a large amount of premium currency, but it also won't do a single thing for you. Last time I played, I was salty that I didn't get the white-haired ponytails character that was on the start screen, so I was smidge biased then. On top of this, I didn't get the military mommy right now either, so I don't have many good things to say about the gacha rates. There are purchasable costumes, but overall you don't really need to spend money on anything. As mentioned earlier, the bottleneck is resources, which is to say, your time. SR. I downloaded Punishing Grey Raven because it had a Nier collab. That being said, I did enjoy my fairly short time with the game. Punishing Grey Raven has pretty unique gameplay, in that it emulates the hack and slash style pretty well. Therein lies an issue. The controls don't feel great to handle on mobile. They're manageable, but it's still somewhat inconvenient feeling skill capped by design. Of course, there is a desktop version, but I despise playing gacha games on anything but mobile. There are a variety of game modes, which tend to have different gameplay that's all fun. How's the longevity? It would honestly be pretty good for someone else. My biggest gripe is again that using the mobile controls makes it so that I don't enjoy the gameplay as much as I probably should. At this point, I think it's clear that I rate the longevity of a game based on whether or not the gameplay becomes a chore without room for changing up the dynamic on my end. For example, Fate Grand Order's different character skills, cards, noble phantasms, and all that allowed for mixing and matching to create different team compositions that makes different engagements feel fresh. Genshin, loath I am to admit it, also had this for a long while, where you could assemble different parties that focus on different buffs or elemental reactions. Punishing Grey Raven has the capacity for this too, in the sense that you can assemble varied party compositions. Unfortunately, this variability does not waive my underlying issue with mobile controls. Lastly, you need to whip out the credit card in PGR? No, do not whip it out. Overall an SR, but if I play on desktop, it might honestly get bumped up to SSR. Nikke, Goddess of Victory, has some of the most unique gameplay among all gacha games. It's a third-person shooter mobile game. For filth like me who will play gacha games based purely on art, they are PNGs after all, having innovative gameplay is always a welcome addition. That being said, this could very well be a skill issue. I really hate having to aim on mobile. For example, with the Gravedigger Interception boss, the damn thing moves around too spastically for my thumb to accurately hit the weak point zones, which, if you don't break those in time, the boss practically one-taps your squad. This means that team compositions that should be able to clear the boss based on stats are getting mogged. What accentuates this is that most battles also have an auto-aim option, which is better than most players, including myself. The issue with this is that the auto-aim will never target weak points, so it doesn't help when it really counts. I will admit, there is a desktop version of Nikke that would completely remove this problem, but again, I have reached a point where I refuse to play gacha games if they're not on mobile. Beyond the innovative mechanic, most dailies can be auto-completed, but the simulation room cannot, which is somewhat annoying, but not the end of the world. Regarding the longevity, I will fully admit that I played for about a month on release and stopped playing. I only came back to the game very recently on account of a Nier collab, Speaking of the collab, it was surprisingly good, and the story encapsulated what I expect a good collab with Nier to be like. 2B's character dialogue was a little off, but it is a completely different situation than those we normally see her in, so I'll permit it. That being said, holy hell. Look, I know the memes are that 2B has a giant ass, but Nikke managed to double it. As an aside, it also mildly irritates me that they made A2's worn down chassis into a latex tank top. I understand the confusion, but that is not cloth. She is naked and her synthetic skin substitute has been weathered down to nothing. Anyway, the collab was fun. The gameplay was the same, but I'll probably stop playing once the event ends again, which isn't a great sign. Now, how necessary is a credit card in Nikke? Not particularly, even though it feels like the gacha rates are not as advertised more often than not. If you want the extra goodies, then Nikke will squeeze you for all you're worth. The season passes aren't super expensive, but they also don't give a whole lot in the first place. On the other hand, skins are about $20, and in the Nier event, getting the 2B reincarnation skin will probably cost you $60 based on the abysmal grab bag rates. So yeah, SR, mostly because the gameplay gets repetitive without much room for user side innovation. Path to Nowhere. I downloaded it, played it, and have no recollection of having played it. A concession is that it has a very unique art style as far as gacha games go, but having no memory of its core gameplay and longevity is a very bad sign. If I were being more fair, then I'd play this game again, but I just have no interest in doing so. I'd called it fodder, but in the interest of being as fair as possible, I'll just place it at C. I downloaded Valkyrie Connect because it had a Hololive EN2 collab, which I completed. Valkyrie Connect is also a pretty standard gacha game. It has a stamina resource, character equipment, upgrade materials, and automatic battles. That is to say, everything I had to say about Nier Reincarnation holds true here. I'm going to level with you. I haven't opened this game ever since the Hololive collab ended, and I don't think I will in the future. Overall, R. It's not bad, but it's not standout in pretty much any measure. The chibis are kind of cute though.
Alright, I think we're about done here.
Hold on a minute, what are these over here? Devil Maker Tokyo closed so long ago that I've all but forgotten about the gameplay. However, I will never forget that lobby theme. Easiest URL of my life. Next. New tier. I enjoyed the character art, but the 6-star pull rate was 0.5% and I remember that vividly. Never mention this to me again. Bye.